worked with you. I hope you had sound for the end. Thank you.
Jen. And my councillor and two I've also worked as a consultant for 15 years. I'm not seeking work on the Wirral. And consultants are often the like an easy target, a lazy target for criticism, because many and most do really good work. Interims do loads of good work, I'm sure, and I would think should be thanking them for the work. But I'm sure there are some who's the greater chain and the figures some of them do look extravagant, particularly in times of austerity. When a lot of people are also ages of work for a minimum wage or their living wage, when you don't work, you don't. There's a number of ways to address this. I think I would like to see more information, really, particularly in the reports. In general, in reports, I think we could benchmark with Wirral in the past, we could benchmark with other local authorities. On this issue, we could also benchmark with national government. You know, the Conservative government pays eye-watering amounts to consultants and senior executives, and they're leading by example there. It's not an example we should necessarily follow. Some local authorities like Bristol have a salary ratio cap, so the most somebody could earn for Bristol Council is 10 times what the lowest wage that people earn for Bristol Council. That's one way of addressing these issues. And I think there's also an issue around the rates that are paid and the duration, and an issue around the controls. What are the So issues around the rates that are paid, especially the high end of the scale, and the duration of those contracts, and issue around control systems, how are they, what's the business case for that, how are they assessed and controlled so that there's a huge profit extraction between them.
Right, Chairman,
thank you.
Well, again, you know, I work with Liz to part of the senior team. Clearly, as you say, not really it's about other than, you know, to Cllr Bird's comments about sometimes you will get particular issues that require external expertise that you can't get in the other markets, but you might not get fast enough to do a certain job. And, you know, Liz has pointed out, you know, I arrived here back in June, and, you know, I'm new here, I'm classically new, and I see people around me who do provide a certain specialism that I know is quite difficult to get permanent staff. So I've got project work, for example, that's needed to be done. And my area, particularly around the commercial deal that the council is doing around property and development, you can't get that permanently because it's, you know, the market rate is so hard, and you have to bring that in on an interim basis. I think back to the point that Liz has made about we now have systems in place to ensure that, you know, there's a rationale for bringing people in, but there's also an end date and a clear outcome for the work as well. You know, with the council, as council is really come under pressure, you will start to get more of this appearing elsewhere as well, because, you know, councils will come under pressure potentially, but then we ask to be more innovative at the same time, and that becomes a hard balance to deliver. So I think for us it's really a case of ensuring that we maintain a clear fix on the business case process, the rationale, the end date, the outcomes, but also that we ensure we're getting value for money. Councillor Foulkes has talked about when you are under pressure in certain key services, right, if you don't deliver on the services, the sanction is far more expensive than what you shell out of the start, you know, particularly children's services. Seen councils who have put special measures in the tens of millions of pounds of extra cost. So it's those sorts of factors you're playing there as well.
Yeah, I thought Dave's comment was really interesting in terms of being an LGA contact. Not only us, there must be other councils around the
group. Yeah, it's not just
the same way. So I wonder if that's. You'd have to bear with me because I haven't shared the long time. So is this something that we can do for a recommendation to the LGA? Does anybody know?
Well, we need to get the council to
Would like to monitor this on the issue on a regular basis to ensure absolute discipline is exercised during these appointments. And we ask the LGA for a comprehensive report on this worrying matter. So I'll read it out as I've written it. It was noted that austerity and new ways of working will always require new temporary skills to allow the borough to develop. Committee note the Fall of Frank report, which will raise public interest. We welcome assurances that a business case for such expenditure has to be justified. We would ask for further reports to this committee and would like to monitor this issue on a regular basis to ensure absolute discipline is exercised. Finally, we ask the LGA for a comprehensive report on this weird matter. And I think that is, does allow us to continue to support and have that bit of discipline, have that scrutiny over a long period of time. This is not new. We've had figures close to about 10 years, so it's not new what's going on. I think that's a more sensible way of going forward. And I would move that chair.
Recently, the Strategic Investment Fund, or the SIFT, was relaunched in terms of phase two. This is around £500 million fund over the next 5 years. And as you know, this is to help boost economic growth and regeneration across the city and region, make sure that we use funding to hit the priorities that we've already agreed that are important for the city region. As I say, around £100 million is available for the first year, and then around £500 million over the next 4 years. To support projects in relation to economic growth, transport, housing, infrastructure, skills and culture to boost economic growth. And one of the key principles that's really been emphasised in the relaunch of SIF in terms of SIF Round 2 is a real commitment to social value and to make sure that applicants and projects really can demonstrate how they not just deliver economic growth but deliver economic inclusive growth. And examples I put there are, so they would want that, funded ones to the applicants can demonstrate social impact in terms of maximising local jobs, local supply chains, real jobs that pay a living wage, recognise trade unions, create apprenticeships and internships, and as I say, really promote use of local supply chains and labour. So that's a far more stronger principle embedded in SIP 2 in this latest round. Recent announcements around tackling homelessness and rough sleeping across the city region. In terms of a funding announcement in relation to housing first of around £7.7 million for the city region recently announced. And further detail about how this funding will be used is being worked up in collaboration with local authorities and housing providers, and our rural offices are closely involved in shaping that. But the principle is that the fund is to enhance and add value to an existing activity that we're already working on across the city region to tackle homelessness and to tackle rough sleeping. As I say, real detail about what it could be used for is being worked up and we'll come back. But some key principles that I've highlighted there that we would want to see. But it's about commissioning jointly across the city region and looking at skilled, well-trained, supported staff, looking at a responsive on-call 24/7 support service, and really focusing on mental health services as well to help support tackle homelessness and sleepers. So we're building more detail about how that funding will be used to come, but I think the key principle is that it is to enhance and build on existing activity across the city region. It's a collaborative approach with the work that we're already doing. Recent announcements around tackling poor air quality across the city region, this is a big priority. As I said earlier, it's to support economic growth, but making sure economic growth is inclusive and environmentally sustainable. So the intention is that an air quality task force will be established with political representation across six local authorities, again to enhance and build on existing activity that we're looking at, but to really tackle poor air quality and pockets of poor air quality, which are quite severe in some pockets of the city region and really have a significant impact on residents' health. And really life expectancy as well. And I think there's a growing realisation, and this came out of a big piece of work that was tackled by the Scrutiny Committee, the Combined Authority, that we really need to highlight these issues and look at some good practice in terms of solutions to tackle it. A lot of the issues are in relation to transport and emissions from transport, so it really links quite well to the role that the Combined Authority has a strategic transport planning and infrastructure going forward as well. An update to the Combined Authority on quite detailed activity in relation to High Speed 2 and the whole Northern Powerhouse rail infrastructure and priorities around that. We obviously all understand the importance of transport to economic growth and our ambitions across the city region and indeed the wider north. And there's a couple of areas of focus on this. One is around looking at Northern Powerhouse rail, and the second is looking at High Speed 2 links. So the first one is around transport infrastructure within the north, so from west to east, and improving connectivity from the city region across the wider north. And obviously High Speed 2 is how we can link the city region to the developments to link to the Midlands and London and the South East really. And in particular, a potential economic boost and significant impact that that infrastructure could have, which we get around really. So, there is obviously lobbying that's continuing to take place to really make sure that Liverpool potentially is linked into HS2. And there's an extensive range of economic impact assessments that have been carried out recently that really demonstrate the potential value and impact that that could have if that happens. And I've highlighted some of those there really in terms of potential £15 billion GBA added benefits from journey time saving for property developments, potentially an extra 24,000 jobs, and 3.6 million more visitors per annum. So there's a real kind of increasingly strong economic impact case for the value of being linked to HS2. And I think the intention is that there'll be some significant data in the coming months, not least including an outline business case for Northern Powerhouse in December, and publication of wider strategic transport plan in January for the north. And then finally, I'll just highlight some of the work around, we're working on a programme around the city region becoming Year of the Environment for 2019. detailed schedule of events is being put together at the moment, and it links to the government's national year of the environment, where it's quite significant for Wirral, I think, on two levels. One is that it will really give us an opportunity to showcase some of the work we're doing around environmental sustainability, the green agenda, offshore wind, and our maritime industry. And also that it aligns really well to us becoming more of culture for 2019 as well, in terms of some of the outdoor activities using our brilliant countryside and coastal areas, particularly around things like cycling, getting people to get out more. So some real opportunities to link a year of the environment with the year of more of culture. So I think those are the ones I just wanted to sort of highlight. I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you for that. Can I just ask, you mentioned about social value. Do we measure, I mean, I'm guessing that we procure from a contract, similar to the matrix, where all the city regions buy into one, or buy from one preferred supplier. Do we have any measurements of, would we know, for example, what the top, say, 20 items are that are purchased, and where they're purchased from? If we are buying from local companies, or are we going to Manchester, or Birmingham, or London, wherever? And I suppose really the Matrix contract was one of the ones I was thinking about, where they based the recruitment company, who was S, I can't remember the name of that without looking, but Matrix, I guess, is the system. So that would be good to note.
Okay. It's a really good question. It's actually a piece of work that we're about to embark on to really get to grips with that. I think it links to the work we're doing around Cllr's, if you're aware of that, that we're also going to be doing some work around local wealth creation. And a key part of that is mapping public sector spending and looking at where we actually spend it. There's an opportunity to look at doing that across the city region, but for instance, to really get to grips with that, to understand the baseline of what we're going to spend, and importantly, how we can maximise and improve that. So we're optimistic that will sort of start early in the year time to do exactly that, really. Brian, is there anything you wanted to add to that?
Just on the back of that, the New Economics Foundation, they're based in Liverpool, so we work in the land as well?
Yes.
Thank you. Thanks for those few reports. Just a couple of questions. On the 3.2 LCR housing first, with the combined budget of more than 7.7 million. Is that to deal with the issues laid out in the report, separate to what Middle Council can deal with itself? Or is it part and parcel of the same thing? I say that because I know that Will has 121,000 in the fund to help homeless people that hasn't spent in the last 12 months. So I'm just wondering if we sit on that pocket of money for some reason, and the government's passed over 7.7 million, and it mentions homeless in the report. Is that in addition to, or is part of?
The 7.7 is an additional amount, and the intention is to build on and enhance what we're doing locally across the city region. So it's very much to build on.